for the concert of Allegra. And tonight we're going to start in a very intimate formation, just piano and viola. The composer that we're going to perform, his name is Arvo Pärt. He was born in Estonia in 1935. And he's famous for his minimalist style. He invented the style of Tintinnabuli. He was very much inspired by Gregorian chant, and you will hear a lot of that inspiration in the piece that you're going to perform tonight. The name of the piece, Fratres, which means brothers. And I would like to quote his explanation of this style. Tintinnabulation is an area I sometimes wander into when I am searching for answers in my life, my music, my work. In my dark hours, I have the certain feeling that everything outside this one thing has no meaning. The complex and many-faceted only confuses me, and I must search for unity. What is it, this one thing, and how do I find my way to it? Traces of this perfect thing appear in many guises, and everything that is unimportant falls away. Tintinnabulation is like this. The three notes of a triad are like bells. And that is why I call it tintinnabulation. Tintinnabuli is the mathematically exact connection from one line to another. Tintinnabuli is the rule where the melody and the accompaniment is one. One and one. It is one. It is not two. This is the secret of this technique. I could compare my music to white light, which contains all colors. Only a prism can divide the colors and make them appear, and this prism could be the spirit of the listeners. So here's the Fratres by Arvo Pärt for viola. Actually, I have forgot to say that this piece was so popular, and there are so many arrangements exist of this beautiful composition, and one of them is for viola and piano. Have a good evening. Thank you.
We will continue now with a reading of the Shostakovich Trio No. 1. Unlike the Elgar, which we will conclude tonight's concert with, the Trio of Shostakovich is a pièce de jeunesse. It's a very early work. It's a work that contains all the building blocks, all the elements of his later style, the sarcasm, the sort of sardonic wit and bite, but it also contains something that was lost, and that is a sense of hope. There's a lot of dream-like music, almost naive, almost childlike, and that's not a feature of Shostakovich's mature style, but it makes us think what could have been had his life been otherwise. The cliché of Shostakovich as a depressive Soviet dissident is perhaps overplayed. What his friends and family recall above all, Shostakovich has a daughter who is still living, recall is his sense of humor. Apparently, when Jimi Hendrix passed away, Shostakovich was tickled pink that he had somehow survived this musical icon. He was still writing music. He said that no bookie would have ever given odds for him surviving Jimi Hendrix. He was also a great lover of sport. At one time, he earned more money as a professional soccer referee than he did as a composer. Music's innate ability to be ambiguous is one of its greatest strengths, and in Shostakovich's case, it probably saved his life on more than one occasion. At any rate, we will, as always, allow you to come to your own conclusions regarding the meaning of this early trio. Thank you.
I'd like to mention our benefit gala concert in just under 1 month, Wednesday the 13th of December, with none other than Yannick Nézet-Séguin, the music director of l'Orchestre Métropolitain here, the Philadelphia Orchestra and the Metropolitan Opera. He'll be playing not one piece, not two pieces, but three pieces. It's rare enough to hear him play the piano, but he'll be doing three pieces that night. Ma Mère Noire Suite, forehand piano with Dorothy. He'll be playing the Elgar Piano Quintet and a wonderful arrangement of the most beautiful slow movement of a Mozart piano concerto. Nous continuons maintenant avec la musique de l'Allemand Max Reger. Entre 1909 et 1911, Reger a décidé d'écrire des pièces pour ses amis. Et il avait une bonne amie, un altiste, Maurice, c'est quoi son nom, Maurice quelque chose, pardon. Et pour Maurice, il a écrit trois pièces. Et deux des trois pièces étaient particulières, parce que en même temps, il a écrit ces pièces pour Rato, mais aussi pour une autre personne qui était proche de lui, qui quitter son fils, un clarinettiste, Max Félix Reger. Alors, la première pièce qu'elle écrit pour Maurice était un double concerto, un concerto pour son fils et Maurice, un double concerto pour clarinette et alto, qui était joué d'ailleurs par l'Orchestre Métropolitain l'année passée, avec Elvire et moi. Et la deuxième pièce qu'il a écrite pour Maurice, mais aussi pour son fils, était huit miniatures, huit trios pour clarinette, alto et piano. Et la troisième pièce qu'il a écrite est la pièce que vous allez entendre maintenant. C'était une pièce pour alto, solo et grand orchestre. For Max Reger, the clarinet and the viola had a certain adjacency in terms of interchangeability. And indeed, there's a historical precedent for substituting clarinet and viola. Indeed, Brahms arranged his clarinet sonatas for viola. But above and beyond those considerations, this piece is incredibly beautiful. It's more chamber music than a solo piece. And when music is this good, it doesn't really matter who the soloist. It could be a viola, a clarinet, a violin, a bassoon, an oboe, a flute. What is incredible is that this piece is more chamber music than a mini concerto. So without further ado, we hope you enjoy what we consider to be one of Max Reger's most touching, poignant, and communicative pieces of music. This is his Romance, Opus 85, originally written for viola and orchestra, but tonight reimagined for clarinet and string quartet.
Thank you.
We will conclude tonight's concert with a reading of the Elgar String Quartet in E minor. It's a late work of Elgar. He wrote it at the very end of his life, and an unsettling feature of Elgar's final compositions, the cello concerto, the violin sonata, and the piano quintet, is they share a common key, and that is in itself an enigma. It's not common for composers to write a whole series of pieces in the same key. We don't really know the meaning behind this common key of E minor, which is, it's a sad key, but it's sad in a quiet way. It's a gentle kind of sadness. But your guess is as good as ours when it comes to why he would have chosen to do this. We know that Elgar was very depressed at the end of his life. He was very saddened by the loss of a generation of youth during the First World War. He was sad at the loss of the life that he had known prior to the war, and the disappearance of the culture that he had known. But we know that Elgar was by nature an optimist, so there's always a smile through the tears in his music. But it's a work that definitely looks back. Elgar quotes himself a lot in this work. Elgar's most famous composition, of course, is the Enigma Variations, but in this quartet, he, like he did in the Enigma Variations, he quotes many other works that he had written previously. So it's a work that looks back, both in terms of Elgar's own compositions and also to a former style. Although it was written in the 20th century, it's a piece that looks towards the past with nostalgia. It conjures up images of wind going through the trees of a graveyard, of wind and mist, but always with a smile. So we hope you will enjoy this reading of the Elgar String Quartet in E minor.
Thank you.
Thank you.